Good to have you all here this morning. Thank you all for coming. It's a blessing to be together. Why don't you join me in standing? We're going to sing, "And Can It Be?" Be seated. And we have the delight here this morning. The Glovers are going to come and share with us to minister to us in music.
Thank you.
Lord. Thank you, Jack and Rory. That was a blessing. Amen. Thinking about that, and Can It Be, we just sang a minute ago, and then that song goes along with it, thinking about a fountain flowing. Does it specify what the fountain's talking about? I was thinking about God's love. And Can It Be, what we just sang, thinking about how God became flesh and dwelt among us. He humbled himself and he bled, it says, for Adam's helpless race, so that those who put their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ can be clothed in his righteousness, and we do not dread condemnation or judgment. That's a huge blessing. And because of that, because God first loved us, then we can sing, "Oh, how I love Jesus." Join me in prayer. Father, thank you so much for this morning, for the opportunity to be here gathered as a local church in order to worship and adore you, to encourage one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, to hold one another accountable, to live in accordance with your word. Father, we give thanks to you for the opportunity and for the fellowship that we have with one another, and that truly our fellowship is with you. Lord, we thank you so much for your love toward us. We can't even fathom why you would love us, but thank you, God, that you have, that you're so good and so kind and so patient toward us, and that you loved us first, that you gave your Son to die for our sins. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Thank you. Thank you that he's risen from the dead, that he's ascended and sitting at your right hand. And thank you, Lord, that because of your love for us, we can love you. We can love one another. We're so thankful. Father, thank you for your faithfulness. We adore you because every promise and every threat that you have made, every single one of them will come true. You always keep your promises. You always perform your word. And Lord, because of that, we can rest confident in you. Because of your faithfulness toward us, Lord, please strengthen our faith toward you. And Lord, we give thanks to you for that. May we be confident, persuaded, fully persuaded that you are able to keep that which you've committed because you are faithful. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. So our next song here is "I Know Whom I Have Believed." Our scripture reading this morning is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. We're going to read verses 12 through 24. First Thessalonians chapter 5, beginning there, verse 12. And we beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you, and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly, in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient toward all men. See that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. Rejoice evermore. Pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the spirit, despise not prophesyings, prove all things. Hold fast that which is good. Abstain from all appearances of evil. And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray God, your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Faithful is he that calleth you, who also will do it. Praise the Lord. Would you join me in standing one last time as we adore God for his faithfulness toward us?
There is no shadow of turning.
Pastor, we'll turn it over to you.
All right. So right before we begin our church update here today, I want to just quickly remind you, we do have family camp at Cowboys Rest coming up this next weekend. Today and tomorrow are your last days to sign up. If you don't have that information, it's up on our website. Talk to Mr. Daniel if you've got a question about that. But make sure you sign up in the next couple days because I've got to turn in final numbers to the camp so that they can purchase groceries, etc. And we can have the family camp this next weekend. But before I actually get rolling on the church update here today, what I'd like to do is we're going to give just a quick update on the building committee update, all right? And so what I'd like to do is, again, for many of you that are aware of this, there has been a committee that we put together a while back concerning the building a new sanctuary project. And so I need to give a quick update concerning that. Now, this obviously comes with a number of questions that I need to answer right away. All right, so I just want to be aware, or want you to be aware, of what's been going on. The building committee has been diligent about their task, but we started the building committee project last year, well before COVID was even a word that we knew the meaning of, and we already committed money to pay for the building plans and engineering for a new sanctuary. In other words, it's already kind of set in stone. We already paid the money out, and we've got to kind of get this first leg of the project complete. But then, of course, this is the question on everybody's mind. The question now is, will we ever need a new sanctuary? Is this really the best way to spend our money in the current environment of uncertainty? In other words, we have, you know, a lot of questions. And as I will say again, and I've said before, my dad used to say, I'm not a prophet nor the son of a prophet, and I work for a nonprofit organization. All right? So I can't tell the future, but nonetheless, we do have some questions, don't we? What will be the political environment? What will be the economic environment in the near future? Is this really the best way to spend our money? And these are obviously questions that we don't have ultimate answers for yet. But just realize that we've already committed the money to get the plans up to this point. And once the plans are complete, and I really need to update that in my notes, I say there that they're good for 2 years, but I actually talked to Steve Kingwell, who is kind of heading up the whole project. I talked to him this morning. He actually said, unless the building codes change, they're good indefinitely. So once we get the engineering done, the plans done, which we've already committed the money to do, then they're good. And we can hold on to those for as long as we want to before we actually pull the trigger and start the process of building. So obviously, we do not know what the future holds, but we are looking to the Lord for guidance regarding each step. And so just by way of kind of, trying to be transparent and let you know what's going on, we are hopeful that by the time that we get to next spring, we will have, you know, the time that we would typically start if we were on schedule to start the building project. We will have a clearer picture by then of the political and economic environment and whether or not, you know, that's the right choice to make. And so if you are there's pictures. I don't think they took them down, right? There were still pictures out in the foyer, right? We had them up in the first service. If not, I will get them up again. But the building committee has already decided on a floor plan for the new sanctuary. What they're working on next is kind of the internal views, what it'll all look like, how they're going to repurpose some of this old building here, like this room, this space. There's some other things they haven't yet decided on, but the actual floor plan for the new sanctuary is already decided on. They voted on that. It's set. The engineering plans are underway. And there are pictures out in the foyer. If you are curious to take a look at that and to kind of get a bit of a visual of what that might look like, all right? So if that is something that you're interested in, again, talk to the building committee. Steve Kingwell is the head of it. There's about 12 different members. We can get you those names of folks that are on the committee. You're welcome to, you know, go up to any of them, ask questions, etc. But they have been diligently at work during this, you know, pandemic, and yet we'll see what happens later as we finish those plans, get them in hand, and then watch and see what is the right move. When is the right move if we can build a new sanctuary? And so we'll see. Stay tuned, but we'll see what the Lord does in that. All right, so With that said, I'd like to transition. As I mentioned last week, I want to focus today. We're taking a quick pause from the book of Daniel and our study of the book of Daniel. We'll get back to it next week. But I want to spend today investing some time in a church update. There's a number of things that I would like you to be aware of so that we need to be on the same page about. Now, here's my goals for today. I want to first just inform you concerning the political environment of which we're a part. We'll talk a little bit about California, what's going on over there. I alluded to that last week, as well as the political environment here locally in Nevada. And we've got some things that are concerning. And if you're aware of them, great, I'm glad. Keep an eye on them. If you're not aware of them, that's the purpose of today, is to highlight that there are some things going on where in our country, religious liberty is indeed under attack. And so we will see how that affects us as a church in particular, but I want you to be aware of it. So number one, I want to inform you concerning the political environment. Number two, I want to instruct you concerning the biblical principles that are at stake. In other words, why is this important that there is such a threat to religious liberty? And why? How might that affect us? And what should we be thinking biblically during this time? Next, point three there, I want to forecast our intentions as a church and your ability to be involved in that. In other words, when I say the word our or we, as I work our way through this, I'm talking about the elder board. We as elders have met, as you can imagine, a number of times through this whole pandemic. And we have been thinking and praying and weighing the options and deciding, trying to be very deliberate with what choices we make and how we operate. And so, but nonetheless, again, we're not prophets, but we do see some things coming down the pipeline that may well affect us as a church in the near future. Maybe not. Maybe we're wrong. Maybe it's way out there. Praise the Lord if we got plenty of extra time. But if our religious liberty is under attack, then you need to be aware of it. And then we want to try and put a bit of a battle plan in place and say, okay, how's this going to affect us? How are we going to operate in the middle of this? So that's my goals for today. Now, with that said, let me just get you aware of the fact of what's going on in the political environment over in California. Now, you might be asking this question. Many of you probably understand why I'm going with this, but you might be asking the question, why are we talking about California, right? I mean, it's like we're Nevada. Well, if you're familiar with how this is all going down, then there's been a number of states in the western United States that have actually come out very publicly to announce that they're working together as states, that they're actually doing things harmoniously. They're trying to fight COVID and handle this pandemic in similar ways. And so if you're not aware of that, our governor, Governor Sisolak of Nevada, has teamed up with California and other states, Colorado, Oregon, but we have other states involved, but California is kind of leading the pack when it comes to what happens there. Not always, but often. It's a matter of time, and we may well see it here. And so the point is, that's why I want you to be informed about what's going on over there. And I'm only going to give you two examples. We're not going to be exhaustive on this, but I want you to be aware of a couple of situations that are unfolding as we speak. We've been keeping an eye on these the last couple of weeks, and yet we'll see as it develops in the future, in the next even couple of days, couple of weeks, how some of these things play out. But just for like a two-sentence backstory, the governor of California partially, reopened churches this spring, but commanded them not to sing, if you remember that. He later issued mandates to forbid indoor church services in most counties. In other words, he reopened, but there was a bit of a spike, so he kind of said, oh, everybody back down, nobody go to church, and he singled out churches in particular. Well, Grace Community Church, led by John MacArthur in L.A. County, is being sued by L.A. County because of their meeting indoors for services. Now, they're countersuing, and I learned just this last week that, in fact, President Trump's personal attorney is on this. He's actually, his attorney is defending John MacArthur and trying to stand up for the church there. But nonetheless, they, as a church, have faced multiple threats, including fines for being held in contempt of court, as well as being threatened with jail time. The pastor in particular, John MacArthur, has been threatened with jail time. It develops almost every day. There's a change in this case. Their next major hearing is on September 4th, and we obviously have a lot of interest in how that's going to go down. And we're keeping an eye on that to see what steps they will actually take against this constitutional right. But it's something that it's a battle being waged, and it's right next door. Another example of this, again over in California, there's a church in Ventura County, California, that was ordered by the courts not to meet. County officials threatened to block the church from opening by using sheriff deputies, but that was overturned. In other words, one judge said he would actually have deputies at the door to make sure no one showed up. If you showed up, you were considered in contempt of court and you were able to be prosecuted. But then they were able to appeal. There was a different judge assigned to the case, and he said that's probably not a good idea. So they ended up not doing that, but they nonetheless threatened to. They also, right after that, Ventura County officials did admit to sending spies to the church just weeks prior in order to determine the level of compliance with COVID restrictions. The church is currently facing fines upwards to $3,000 and are still under orders not to meet. And of course, this information is of yesterday, but I have, obviously, I haven't checked on them today. Last I heard, they were trying to determine whether or not to meet today and go ahead and face the fines or what to do, and so I haven't heard. But nonetheless, I think you need to be aware of the fact that this is happening. It's not something that was, you know, it's not something that's like this, hey, rogue possibility, it will never happen in America. No, it's happening. And so the reality is, you need to be aware of that. So where does that leave us when it comes to our political environment here in Nevada? Well, let me just be candid right away. We are in a better situation than California. What is happening there is not yet happening here, at least not on the same scale. So our governor, Governor Sisolak, has allowed certain businesses to operate at 50% capacity, yet still restricts churches to 50 people or less. Now, that is something that were two churches. Many of you are already aware of this, but if you're not, I'm trying to clue you in. There were two churches in Nevada that teamed up and took this all the way to the Supreme Court to basically fight this. And they were claiming discrimination, and they said, hey, why can businesses, casinos, you know, all these other entities operate at 50%, but churches have to be 50 people or less? Like, that's discrimination, isn't it? Well, that got all the way to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court threw it out. They wouldn't hear the case. So in so doing, however, they essentially sided with the governor by saying, okay, during a pandemic, a state of emergency, the Constitution can be temporarily suspended. And so therefore, constitutional right doesn't apply. Governor can do basically what he wants to do. So the point is, that is where we're at politically when it comes to the state level. But what about us locally? Well, Elko County School District, as you know, this was a development just last week, and I'm sure most of you, if not all, are already aware of this. But Elko County School District chose to suspend schools for this quarter. Probably, this will probably avoid that inevitable outbreak we were all anticipating, which is kind of a two-edged sword for us as a church. Because on the one hand, we were kind of thinking, hey, if there is this church, you know, schools reopen, there's going to be a spike in COVID. It's kind of inevitable. So how's the governor going to respond? We anticipated him trying to shut down churches again and just kind of, you know, maybe shut down everything again, or at least really pull back the reins if there was a spike in COVID cases. Well, now that schools are not opening, well, how does that change? I don't know. We probably won't see that huge spike, at least not right away. And so that could be good, but it also leaves churches as very vulnerable, quite, you know, perhaps. We'll see. We'll see what happens. But the point is, without schools meeting, we, churches, are now one of the largest entities meeting locally. Do you see my point? So if there is a quote-unquote outbreak, it's easy to point the finger to us. If the schools were open, right, I mean, you could easily argue, well, it's them, not us, right? But we, you know, we'll see. So the point is, this might leave our church as more vulnerable, but time will tell. Now, the Elko County authorities are currently in the process of forming a plan on how to enforce COVID laws locally. Like, what steps will they take to try and, you know, crack down and make sure businesses and maybe churches are, you know, forced to comply to various standards. Now, this was supposed to be decided this last week. There was a county commissioner meeting that basically met and they said, you know what, we're not ready. And so they kind of kick the can down the road a little bit. The plan itself is not in place yet, so we don't know how that's going to develop. So just keep your eyes out on that. We'll keep you updated, of course, but we don't know how that's going to go down. Now, on the flip side, local authorities, you know, the positive side, our local authorities, we, as in the elders, myself, have had several conversations with local authorities who have, as many of you know, taken a relaxed approach toward the enforcement of COVID restrictions. However, I also have on good authority that the local authorities can actually be replaced by the governor. And so right now we have a little bit of breathing room when it comes to that, as far as, again, our local situation is better than what's going on in LA County or Ventura County over in California. We have authorities that are more conservative, but nonetheless, they can be removed from office if they're not doing what the governor wants them to. So the point is, we are in right now, currently, in a better situation than California. However, we don't know. There's a lot of things in the works that are being kind of developed and decided upon that we will see how this plays out in the near future. Now, with this environment, how should we be thinking? What are the biblical principles at stake? Well, if you got a Bible, go quickly to 1 Peter chapter 2, just briefly. I want to read this passage, because I don't want to just assume that you know what this passage says. And just to be clear, these are principles that we have been emphasizing for the last 5 to 6 months. All the way back to when the shutdown first occurred in March, and you can go back, check our website, YouTube channel, etc., but we did a number of lectures immediately in April that covered much of this information. And so the point is, at least these biblical principles. So the point I'm trying to make is that we've been saying the same thing from the very beginning. We've consistently taught through this, but our environment is changing a little bit. And so we have to stay on top of interpreting the biblical principles and how they apply in our current environment and situation. So 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 11 to 25, let me read this, and we're going to pull three big principles that govern us as Christians all the time, but how do we apply them during this situation is, of course, the question at stake. But 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11 says, "Dearly beloved, I beseech you as strangers and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. Having your conversation honest among the Gentiles, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether it be to the king as supreme, or unto governors, as unto them that are sent out by him, for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. For so is the will of God, that with well-doing you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. As free and not using your liberty for a cloak of maliciousness, but as the servants of God. Honor all men, love the brotherhood, fear God, honor the king. Servants, be subject to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the froward, to the perverse." Verse 19, "For this is thankworthy, if a man for conscience toward God endure grief, suffering wrongfully. For what glory is it if, when you be buffeted for your faults, you shall take it patiently? But if, when you do well and suffer for it, you take it patiently, this is acceptable with God. For even hereunto were you called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps. Who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him who judges righteously, who, his own self, bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you are healed. For you are as sheep going astray, were as sheep as going astray, but are now returned to the shepherd and bishop of your souls." Now again, I'm not going to exposit that passage. I just want to highlight three big biblical principles that are at play when it comes to us trying to answer the question, how do we operate as a church in the midst of this political environment that we find ourselves? Well, first of all, we do have to consider, verses 11 and 12, our testimony to the community. In other words, we need to, by our good works, silence the mouths of people that charge us with being evildoers. Number two, we need to be in submission to our governmental authorities as best as we can. Number three, however, he also implies that we need to suffer, and when we suffer, we need to do it only because of righteousness. In other words, if we are suffering, we need to be sure that we're on the right side. You see that? He says, in other words, we don't just pick a fight to pick a fight. We don't, you know, bring on suffering and persecution from the government just to do it. Rather, it's only reluctantly when the government commands us to do something that God says don't do, or vice versa. They command us not to do something God says to do. Well, then, by doing righteousness, if we suffer as a result of doing righteousness, he says, that's okay. That's good. That is praiseworthy. God commends it. All right? So those are the principles at stake that help us understand, okay, how do we relate to the world and relate to our God at the same time? But the big command that is at stake, that is what we need to wrestle with as a church, is Hebrews chapter 10. Pop over there just briefly. Hebrews 10 verses 24 and 25 is a very important pair of verses that has a lot to say for every circumstance, but I think it's, again, very pertinent for us. Hebrews 10 verses 24 and 25 underscores the necessity of assembly and accountability. Hebrews 10 verse 24 says this, "Let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching." In other words, the biblical command at stake that is happening, again, that in these couple of cases in California where churches are being ordered not to assemble, then the problem is that they are coming in direct conflict. It's either, it's not God and country, it's God or country in that situation. They're having to choose and say, okay, how are we going to assemble? Are there other ways to assemble? Because see, that's the problem of definition that we've got to struggle with. What does it mean to assemble? What does that mean? Because can 10 people assemble? Can 20, 30, 40, 100, 200? What is an assembly? And that's where not every church is going to do the same thing. And it's between them and the Lord. But we as a church and our elder board and how we are leading this church, these are the issues that are at stake. How do we functionally fulfill this command? Because he says, assemble. Why? Because you need to provoke one another to love and good works. That's the word accountability, right? Make sure we are keeping one another accountable to live the Christian life. And he says, this is more important as the day is approaching. In other words, the closer we get to the end times, the more important it is to assemble together, to make sure that we band together and we keep each other on task and we hold each other accountable to do the right thing. So the point is, this is the command that in some scenarios is becoming impossible to fulfill if you follow every governmental guideline. And so that's where we've got to be discerning to draw a line. Now, just so that you are aware of this, the current size and spectrum of our church is as follows. We as in Ruby Mountain Bible Church, ministers to somewhere between 250 and 300 people. That's if you combine both services, and then of course we have mining schedules, and so we have certain families that kind of rotate in and out, you know, a couple times a month. You know the story, but if you add them all together, and we in our database, people that we contact, people that regularly come, that we interact with, that we minister to, we're somewhere between 250 and 300 people. However, within that group, a group of that size, it's inevitable. Attitudes concerning how to deal with the current environment are going to range from total conformity to total non-conformity to any sort of COVID guideline. So the point is, there is absolutely no way of pleasing everybody. Can we agree on that? That's the one thing we can agree on. Okay. There's no way to please everyone, but let me also be clear, that's not our goal. Our goal is not to simply take a poll and try and please, you know, everybody. It's impossible. However, we do want to do, number one, what is right before God, but number two, what is also the best to accommodate our people. How can we minister to our people most effectively and fulfill the commands of Hebrews 10 and other places where we are to fulfill those one another commands? To gather, to love one another, to speak to one another, to provoke one another, love and good works. All those one another commands in the New Testament. How do we do that effectively? Well, this is so far, and this isn't rocket science. I mean, you've been here, for many of you, for the last several weeks and months. This is the approach that we have been taking. We have taken reasonable measures in order to be responsible. This is not news to you, but we have taken a two-service format to reduce capacity. We have also upped our cleaning schedule in order to sanitize the facilities. We've also provided overflow rooms as well as online recordings. We've provided both of those in order to still minister to our most vulnerable, those who are uncomfortable gathering in large crowds. And so we've provided those means to try and still minister to them. We, of course, also conducted an outdoor VBS in an attempt to comply to COVID regulations. In other words, we're trying to be responsible. We're trying to be reasonable. But on the other hand, we have also taken the posture of promoting personal responsibility. What do I mean by that? Two illustrations. The face mask mandate. We have provided face masks, but we do not enforce face masks. Overflow rooms. We provide overflow rooms, but we do not enforce. We don't kick you out or turn you away at the door if there's too many. Why? Well, again, not every church is going to deal with this the same way. That's between them and the Lord. But why have we taken this posture? This could be a long answer, but just in short, because it best matches our theology. In other words, the church is a voluntary organization. You're here because you want to be here. It's a voluntary organization that issues an invitation. And this is not the only place, but Revelation 22:17 is kind of that famous passage upon which the hymn is built, "Whomsoever will shall come." In other words, we don't want to turn people away because you either will or won't wear a face mask. You will or won't. You see what I'm saying? We don't want to turn people away because that's the opposite of the invitation of how we feel. That's the heartbeat of the gospel. And so we don't want to do that, which is why we have promoted personal responsibility. We provide other opportunities for those who are uncomfortable with large groups. However, we're not enforcing every guideline to the T. So that's been the posture that we've taken. So then, with that in mind, how do we intend to proceed? Well, let me just tell you, again, we don't know the future, but this is our intention, in short. We fully intend, as a church, to remain open. That is our desire. That's our utmost desire. We want to remain open, and we would only voluntarily close back down if we see clear and present danger from COVID. In other words, if we see an outbreak in our church, we see people getting sick and infected, and we're the problem. Okay, so we got to make some changes. That's pretty obvious. But if there is clear and present danger, then we will restructure and we will have to shut back down completely, perhaps, if something like that were to happen. However, without that clear and present danger, if we are commanded to close or further reduce our gatherings from the government officials, then we have decided to officially enter a state of civil disobedience. In other words, we're not going to give up ground. We've been meeting and we are trying to maintain our ability to meet. And if we're commanded to reduce or to close down, we're not comfortable with that. Why? Why have we chosen to do that? Well, again, this can be a long answer, but let me give you just a couple of quick categories. First of all, for practical reasons. Again, we minister to somewhere between 250 and 300 people. If we were to accommodate those numbers, practically speaking, and we don't know this, but because, you know, Facebook's a rumor mill, is it not? But the rumor has it, you know, and we'll see what happens. But the rumor has it that Governor Sisolak was wanting to reduce from 50, the number, you know, the cap of 50, down to 25 or something like that. Hasn't happened yet. We don't know if it will happen. But if that were to happen, we practically cannot accommodate the size of our church with those restrictions. That would have to move us to somewhere between 4 and 6 services. I candidly don't have that kind of stamina. You know what I'm saying? I don't think I could do that. We don't have the facilities to break that up into that many small groups and live, you know, get a live service to all of them. We can't do it. Our internet, we got internet issues. Even our internet, you know, recordings are just that. They're recordings. They're not live streams. We have to record it and then post it later because our internet can't support an actual live stream. The point is, practically, it's impossible. If we were forced to reduce further, we cannot stay open and continue to function in any meaningful way with further reductions. But the second thing, and let me be very candid here, and I want to say this very carefully and delicately. Don't take me wrong on this. But I also want to be transparent. The second reason why we feel it urgent to stay open is because of our spiritual duties. In other words, let me give you this illustration. You know, back in March when we did shut down, we were shut down for 6 weeks, during which time it was a very difficult time. I never stopped face-to-face counseling for that entire time. I continued to counsel folks in the church and continued to work as I do now. But since we stopped meeting and we suspended weekly, you know, ministries, etc., people's spiritual routines went out the window. What happened as a result of that? And again, I'm not talking about out there. I'm not talking about other churches. I'm talking about our people. I'm talking about this church. Within our church, we had families disintegrating. We had relationships falling apart. We had deep, deep depressions. We had fits of rage. We had suicidal thoughts. We have marriages falling apart. In other words, for 6 weeks, we just paused, and all we did was an online service. And it wreaked havoc in our church. Now, not to every person to the same degree, but do you see my point? Don't buy into the lie that our government is trying to tell us that churches are non-essential. Don't believe it. That is a lie. We are essential. And we've been saying this for months. Go back and listen to our previous lectures, particularly in April, when we talked about the nature of the church, the purpose and the function of the church. We are an essential entity. And if we neglect our spiritual duties, if I leave my post, what happens? We let sin get a foothold in our church. And our families start falling apart. They may not get COVID, but they lose relationships and families, marriages fall apart. Is that really worth it? I don't think so. So the point is, we cannot in good conscience cease to operate. We won't do that again. We will never do that. But then how are we going to operate in the middle of this? Well, again, we're going to try and remain open unless we are forced to close, and they literally force us to close, but with some very high measure. We'll see what happens. And maybe we're wrong. Praise the Lord. If we got all sorts of time where this never happens, praise the Lord. But it's happening in California. Keep your eye on it. What's going to happen the next couple of weeks? I don't know. Is that going to come here? I don't know. But don't be naive enough to just ignore it. It could very well be on our doorstep in the near future. So how are we going to prepare for this? How are we going to operate in the midst of it? Now, my goal, now don't take this again. I do not mean to be flippant with this word. I mean to be very respectful and intentional. But I want to prepare our church for persecution. I use the P word, persecution. I use that very carefully because on the one hand, if our Chinese brethren heard us use the word persecution, they would laugh. Because this is not persecution, right? What we are facing is nothing compared to what many of our brothers and sisters in Christ have faced throughout much of church history or are currently facing right now in other parts of the world. So I don't want to flippantly use that word and say, oh, we're being persecuted. Now, are we losing some liberties? Are some of our religious liberties that we've enjoyed for centuries in this country, are they being threatened? Yes, they are. However, we need to be careful by just throwing around that word. But on the other hand, you're naive to think that it won't ever happen. All right? Persecution will happen eventually. How soon and in what form, we don't know. We're not prophets, right? Son of a prophet or I work for a nonprofit organization, but it's coming. So how are we going to be preparing for this? All right, let me mention three things. Number one, we need to train our faithful men. Now, go to 2 Timothy 2:2 just briefly, all right? And let me try to make quick work of this. In 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 2, let me highlight this just quickly. This is the swan song of the Apostle Paul, and he says this to Timothy, his protege. He says, 2 Timothy 2:2, "And the things that you have heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also." In other words, he gives us in this verse a means by which we can accomplish the task of preparing our people to face come what may, whatever comes. And essential to this is preparing faithful men. In other words, this was something exposed, and I've mentioned it before, but I'm going to highlight it again. When we shut down, even for 6 weeks, we tried to promote small groups, and we tried to man those small groups with leaders. But here's the thing. It really didn't work that well. It didn't work as well as it should have. In other words, we had a lot of people either reluctant to go to a small group, or we had people feeling unwilling or unprepared to lead a small group. So the problem is we, and it exposed a weakness in our church, and I'm candid enough to admit it, and hey, man, we have a problem here. We got to fix it. We were not ready for that, and we were not flexible enough to do that. That's a problem, because we will last as long as we possibly can, and we're going to do all that we can. But if and when that day comes where we are forced to disband, they lock our building, seize our bank accounts. I mean, how far is this going to go? We'll see. But it's happened to other places. It's happened in history. We need to watch it now. When that happens, and we don't have a public place to meet anymore, and we've got to go smaller, then we've got to be ready for that. So my intention is, and I've been working on this for a while, and I probably won't start it for another couple of months, but I'm preparing a bit of a curriculum, for lack of a better term, to really, it's intensive. It's not going to be, you know, small, it's going to be intense. But I'm making a curriculum to prepare men to be leaders and to be teachers. Now, the one qualifying factor for you to be part of that group, and you come, and I mean, you, if you want to be in on this, you come and talk to me. And great. But then once we start the program, no one else is allowed in, because I got to work with those guys. But if you want in on this, great. But let me tell you, my goal is to give you the means by which you can teach the scripture, you can lead a small group, you can lead, you know, be a leader in this church, and you can do so effectively. Now, you, again, what's the one qualifying factor to get in on that? You need to be a faithful man. In other words, when I say faithful, it means people who are here. They're committed. They come. They attend. They care. They're willing to put in some work. They're willing to be stretched a little bit, to get out of their comfort zone, to learn some new things, to be put to work doing certain things. And we will try to, you know, work with you and get you to learn and to grow. But the point is, we need more people that are willing and able to lead. So we're going to focus on that, which then will help us to do number two, to strategically promote small groups, where we then can build that flexibility right into our church. But until we get there, and even as we're in the process of trying to get there, then this is what, thirdly, we're going to do in the next couple of weeks. We want to conduct a survey of the congregation. And this survey is concerning various matters, that some of which I've just explained, some of them I'll just mention in just a moment. But they are questions and things that are facing us in the immediate future, or the far future. But nonetheless, they are issues that we are facing, decisions that we have to make. And we want you as a congregation to be involved. We want your input. We want your thoughts. We want you guys to speak up. So what we're going to do is we're going to put together a survey. Daniel has done a fabulous job putting together an electronic survey. And what we're going to do is, again, the survey is the whole purpose of it. It is meant to gather feedback. We want to gather information. We want to hear from you. We want to hear all your concerns. We want to accommodate everyone the best that we can. Like I said, let me reiterate, we cannot by any means possibly please everyone, but that is not the goal. Rather, we want to do what is right, number one, to continue to preach the word of God, to minister to our people, but how we do that and in what form, we want to hear your feedback. So we're going to send you a link to the survey. Now, we've built a database all the way back. We've been working on it for months. If we do not have your email or phone number, but you want to participate in this, then get it to either myself or Daniel. You know, get us some piece of information so we can send you a link. And we're going to do this next couple of days. We'll send you a link. And then we're going to take a couple of weeks to let people fill out the survey. In other words, because of schedules and, you know, all the stuff that's people are out of town, et cetera, we want to give plenty of time to have people give feedback. but we want to hear from you so that it will help us as elders make some wise, discerning decisions as we move forward. So this is what you can have to look forward to. This is the survey, and there's 8 questions. You fill it out, submit it to us if you're interested and willing to do so. But number one, I want to hear from you. What is the thing that you miss most about church before COVID? In other words, what I am mining for there is what is it that you value about church? What is it that you miss? What is it that we're not doing now that is a weakness to our ministry, and it's something that is hurting, you know, our flock? So what is it that you miss most? Number two, under what circumstances would you no longer come to in-person gatherings? Under what circumstances would you no longer come to in-person gatherings? All right, we want to know the comfort level of our flock and what we're doing or not doing, which is, again, we pair it with number three there, question number three. If you have not returned to in-person gatherings, what concerns do you have? What is it that we're not doing? What is it that we're failing to do that has brought about the concerns to where you haven't returned to in-person gatherings? We want to hear from you. Number four, would you be willing to attend, host, or lead a small group? Again, you may not be one of those faithful men who is training to lead, but maybe you're willing. And I've already had people do this. They've come up and said, hey, my home's available for a small group. Great. Fill it out. Are you willing to host one? Are you willing to attend one? Are you willing to lead one? Number five, would you like to add a Sunday school hour to our current 2-service schedule? We've had a lot of questions about this. It's something we're willing to do. We have to finagle the schedule a little bit, but we could make it happen. And we want to gather interest. Are you willing to attend? Is it worth us? Because it's a lot of extra work. We got to get more people on board. We got to get the Sunday school class, you know, working. We got to get the junior church back up and running. You know, we've got other things pieces to put into place to get this to happen. But how interested are you? You know, we would have to probably put, you know, in this current 2-service format, we'd have to go an earlier service, probably Sunday school hour in between and a late service. So is that something you're willing to do, interested in doing? Number six, if we took reasonable precautions, would you be comfortable helping or sending your kids to Awana this fall? Again, this is a question that we're facing. Church, you know, we as a church have to decide. School shut down. So what are we going to do? Because Awana's is a big gathering of a bunch of kids, right? And so what are we going to do? And we are willing to host it, but only if you guys are. Do we have enough people that are willing to lead it or send their kids? If Ruby Mountain Bible Church people say, no way, I'm not sending my kids, or I don't want to lead, well then okay, that's fine, but we won't, do you see my point? We won't plan on it. We need to know, we need to hear from you. Number seven, if we enter into a state of civil disobedience, how would you prefer to meet? In other words, if we come to that crossroads where we are ordered either to shut down or to reduce our gatherings and we say, no, we can't do that, then we want to hear from you. What is the format in which you are most comfortable continuing to meet? In other words, do we maintain the 2-service format? Do we recombine to 1 service and provide overflow rooms? How do you want to operate? We want to hear from you. But then, number 8 will just be blank. Any additional comments, just give us your feedback. We'd love to hear from you because these are some things that we are facing as a church, as elders, and we got to make some wise decisions. Now, before we participate here in communion here this morning, give me 10 minutes and let me give you some devotional thoughts from 1 Thessalonians, okay? Because this is incredibly practical. Everything that we just talked about is so beautifully addressed by the scriptures, and it is in many areas, but I love the book of 1 Thessalonians, and I want to highlight this for you so that you can study this on your own. If you have not read the book of Thessalonians ever, please do so. If you haven't done it recently, I encourage you to do so. It's a short little 5-chapter book. It's not long, but what I want you to understand about this little book is 3 things, all right? I'm only going to take 10 minutes to do this, then we'll transition, participate in the Lord's table, and we'll be done for today. But I want to, number one, consider the context of 1 Thessalonians. Number two, I want to consider the content. What is the book all about? Number three, I want to consider the climax, particularly chapter 5. Now, we won't go there for sake of time, but let me clue you in that the context, what is the context of the book of 1 Thessalonians? Who wrote it? Who did he write it to? Why was it written? Paul was writing to a little church in the city of Thessalonica in order to encourage them because they had been birthed, the church came into existence amidst incredible persecution. Now, we won't go there for sake of time, but if you were to read Acts chapter 17, verses 1 to 9, you would discover that the church itself, the city where Paul goes and he evangelizes that city, he preaches in the synagogue for 3 weeks, after which time people are coming to Christ. There's a church that is formed, but the city authorities don't like what's happening, and they decide to crack down on the Christian gathering. They say, quit meeting, and they crack down on them, and as a result, Paul and Silas actually have, Silas at that point, they have to flee the city. And so the point is, Paul flees, the church is back there being persecuted, and so he writes them a letter, and he wants to see how they're doing and encourage them in the midst of persecution. So that is the context of the book of 1 Thessalonians. Well, consider secondly the content of the book. Every chapter, note this, and you can write this down, check them out later. Every chapter, five chapter little book, every chapter ends with an allusion to the second coming of Christ. 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. Chapter 2, verse 19. Chapter 3, verses 12 and 13. Chapter 4, verses 13 to 18, as well as chapter 5, verse 6 and 23. All of those references allude to the second coming of Christ. What does that teach us? Lots of things, but I think here's the big idea. The theme of the book of 1 Thessalonians is all about finding comfort through the second coming of Christ. In other words, how do you minister to a church body, a group of Christians that is struggling during a time of uncertainty when we may well be under the threat of losing our property, right? Our liberties, our freedoms to meet and gather corporately. When that is under threat, how do you minister to people? Well, there's more than one answer to that, but one of the go-to things that the scriptures always point to is to study the second coming of Christ, to study the coming victory that we ultimately have in Christ. That's what Paul does all through the book of 1 Thessalonians, as well as 2 Thessalonians, but that's also why we have been teaching through the book of Daniel. That was a very purposeful decision. Why? Because the narrative portions of the book of Daniel is all about how to stand, how to navigate during very difficult times, particularly in a pagan, hostile governmental environment. So we're learning from the examples of the men in Daniel chapters 1 to 6. But what happens in Daniel 7 to 12? It's all about prophecy. It's all about the end of time. It's the end of the age. It helps us focus, zoom in on the second coming of Christ, the state of affairs that the Bible says will be in existence in the world when Christ comes back. We need to be informed on that. So with that said, let's consider for just a moment, before we participate in the Lord's table, let's consider the climax of the book. Go to 1 Thessalonians 5, and I want to take the time just briefly to read through this chapter. Notice what's going on here. The chapter itself can pretty easily, neatly, be divided in half. The first half, first 11 verses, is all about the second coming of Christ, and we are urged to watch carefully. But then the latter half of the chapter, is verse 12 to 24, is all about living righteously as we await the second coming. It's a very practical chapter. So let's read this just briefly together. 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 1 says, "But of the times and seasons, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you, for yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord comes as a thief in the night. For when they shall say, peace and safety, then sudden destruction comes upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, that day should overtake you as a thief. You are all the children of light and the children of the day. We are not of the night, nor of darkness. Therefore, let us not sleep as do others. Let us watch and be sober. For they that sleep, sleep in the night. They that be drunken are drunken in the night. But let us who are of the day be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. Therefore," notice this, verse 11, "comfort yourselves together and edify one another, even as also you do." In other words, take comfort in this reality. Now, before I read the next paragraph, I just have to say this. I was encouraged the last week or two. I've had a bunch of people in the church text me. Did y'all see that Israel deal go down? President Trump signed a peace deal with Israel. Did you see that? It's kind of fascinating. I got a bunch of people in the church texting and saying, hey, is that the Daniel 9 prophecy? Is that what we've been looking for? Candidly, I don't think it's the one of Daniel chapter 9. There's a number of pieces of the puzzle that aren't there yet. But I think it very well could be setting a precedent. I think it might be the groundwork for that ultimate peace deal that is described in Daniel chapter 9. Now, if you have no earthly idea what I'm talking about in Daniel chapter 9, then keep coming, because we're going to teach through Daniel chapter 9, and you won't be ignorant anymore, okay? And so you need to clue in on this, but what encouraged me about it is that we have multiple people in our church that are like, they're watching. They're saying, you know what? We don't know the day or the hour. We don't know when Christ is coming back, but we know this, this, and this is to take place before Christ comes back. The Bible teaches this. So they're watching, and they're excited when things like that happen. And my phone blows up, and I get all these texts and questions. It's great. I love it. But the point is, watch carefully. But number two, let's read verses 12 to following. 1 Thessalonians 5:12 says, "And we beseech you, brethren, to know them that labor among you and are over you in the Lord, and admonish you, and to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake, and be at peace among yourselves. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, be patient toward all men. See that none render evil for evil unto any man, but ever follow that which is good, both among yourselves and to all men. Rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the spirit, despise not prophesying, prove all things, hold fast to that which is good, abstain from the appearance of evil, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly. And I pray, God, your whole spirit, soul, and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." And then here's the anchor of the whole text, verse 24. "Faithful is he that calls you, who also will do it." Now, we do not have the time to exposit this passage, but let me summarize. This is what Paul says. While we watch and we await the second coming, how are we to live in the meantime? I would encourage your own deep study of that section, but here's the summary. We need to live respectfully and harmoniously, verses 12 to 15. In other words, he says, there are leaders attempting to lead in difficult times. Be gracious with us. We're human. We're going to make mistakes. Be patient with us. But the best thing that you can do to help your leaders, end of verse 13, be at peace among yourselves. Hold to Christian charity. Pursue Christian unity. Not everybody in here has the same idea of how we should operate in the times ahead. That's okay. But be unified in Christ. He says in verses 16 to 18, you could summarize it as follows. He says, live joyfully and prayerfully. In other words, how can we, in the midst of such difficult, trying circumstances, how can we still have joy? Because, he just read, verse 9 and 10, "For God has not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we shall live together with him." The reality is, we read the end of the book, right? We're going to win. And so the reality is, that can bring us joy, even in the midst of very difficult times. So it's important for us to hold to that, so we can live joyfully and prayerfully, band together, be praying. I get together regularly with different believers to pray. It is encouraging. It's one of the best times of my week. Do you do that? Do you take this seriously? Number three, we are to live with fervency and discernment, verses 19 to 22. He says, "Prove all things, hold fast that which is good." In other words, we are living in a time of incredible misinformation. We got all sorts of things going on. We need to be very discerning, but be fervent. Care about it. That's the point. But then lastly, verse 23 and 24, we need to entrust ourselves to God's faithfulness. Because the reality is, we're not to do any of this stuff on our own. The only way we can live a faithful Christian life is by focusing on the faithfulness of God. It's all about God and his character. And he's the one, as it says, who ultimately is faithful, and he will do it. He is the one who will bring about all these end times events in the way that and time that he sees fit. So that's the source of our hope. Now, what I want to do is we'll close in prayer here, and I want to transition to the Lord's table. And as we do this, I want to encourage you to, again, turn to 1 Corinthians 11. I'm just going to touch upon this briefly. This is a well-known passage for you guys. But as we close in prayer here, we will then take a moment of silence, during which time we focus upon the purpose of the Lord's table, communion, as we call it. And we haven't done this for a while, and I'm encouraged by a number of you that approached me and asked me about it. They're like, hey, man, we haven't done communion in a while. We need to do it. You're exactly right. Biblically, it's a command. We need to be doing this. There's flexibility. It says as often as you do it. God doesn't tell us how often to do it. You could be doing it at home. That's fine. But as a church body, we need to regularly participate in the Lord's table. And as we do this, let me remind you of the purpose and why we're doing this. Because this memorial is just that. It is a memorial. It's a means of remembrance of the person and work of the Lord Jesus. The very thing that we can take joy in, 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 9 and 10, that we are not appointed to wrath, but we will receive salvation and live forever with him. How can we take joy in that? And why is that even available for us? Because of what Christ has done for us. The body that was broken, the blood that was shed. We ought never forget why our eternity is secure. It's because of the person and work of the Lord Jesus. And the mechanism that God has ordained to make sure that we never forget that is the Lord's table. It's communion. And so what we're going to do is we are going to take that moment of silence, as Paul encourages us to do. I'll close in prayer here. Then we'll take a few moments of silence, after which I will close that moment in prayer. I'll have our men come forward, those that are helping to hand out the elements here. And we'll participate in the Lord's table here together. And as we do that, recognize the whole purpose is to be thankful and not lose that heart, that attitude of gratitude to the Lord Jesus for what he's done for us. All right, so let's pray and take that moment of silence, and then we'll participate. Father, thank you for this time this morning. Thank you for the book of 1 Thessalonians. Thank you, Lord, for the comfort that we can have in Christ. Though, Lord, we have a world of uncertainty that surrounds us. And Father, as we think of the current political, economic environment, we have all these questions swirling around our heads. We have all these ideas of how it's going to go down, what's going to happen, what is going to take place, even as we are watching the court cases unfold in California, what's going to come here. Lord, we have so many questions. And yet, Father, we understand that you are faithful, that we can trust in you every step of the way. So God, please help us during these moments of silence where we get with you and we check our hearts and we check our spirits and we see if we have unconfessed sin, if we are unresolved in our obedience to you, that Lord, during this moment of silence, that you would encourage each of us as we come to you individually to clear up our accounts between you and ourselves. Lord, may we recommit ourselves to faithfulness to you. And Lord, as we do this, may you be honored. Lord, may you magnify yourself. May we be encouraged during these moments. Father, thank you for this time. And help us, Lord, as we each individually now search our hearts. Thank you, gracious Father, for this glorious day. Thank you for the second coming of Christ that we all eagerly await. We pray that, Lord, you would help us in the meantime to live righteously, to watch carefully. And as we participate in this memorial here this morning, Lord, may you magnify yourself and help us to renew our commitment to you
And Lord, may you reinvigorate our love for you, for your glory and our good. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, if the men who are designated to help hand out the elements to you, please come forward. Appreciate you guys. The Oars put a lot of work into this. We're handing out little packets, really brilliant, I would say, on the elements here. So they're going to go through, hand these out, and then we will participate in the Lord's table here together. All right, so thank you. Let's go ahead and commit ourselves to the Lord. Be thankful for who he is and what he's done for us as we participate in the elements. Thank you, gentlemen. Go ahead and pass those out. Verses 23 and following, the Apostle Paul says this: "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." The Bible then says that after the same manner also he took of the cup. Verse 25, after the same manner also he he took of the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament or New Covenant, promised in the Old Testament, fulfilled in the New. It says, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do you as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Gordy, would you want to close this in a word of prayer, my friend, and thank the Lord for the time, and we'll be dismissed.
Heavenly Father, we're so grateful to you that you allowed us to be here this morning here. And Lord, as long as you will, we ask that you continue to allow that. We pray, Lord, that you heard the praises we sang to you. And Lord, we pray that you keep in our hearts the words that were taught today. We love you, Lord. We're grateful to you. And we thank you, first and foremost, for the love that you have for us. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a great week.